finish what we started last week. I wasn't able to finish our first teaching, but I want to teach you, continue to teach out of the book of Romans. We entitled this teaching, Our So Much More God. And if there are any veterans in the house, I want we as a congregation and as a people want to thank you and yours for your service. Let's let them know how much we appreciate and love them. Come on, church. Hallelujah. Let's stand up and let them know how much we appreciate and love them. Come on, our veterans. Hallelujah. Especially our Vietnam veterans. Glory to God. And so as we go to chapter 5 of Romans, the theme there is the Apostle Paul teaching the church in Rome how to live by faith. The reason I believe that Paul kind of dives right into faith is because Paul understands that without faith, it is impossible to please God. You see, Paul led a very tough life. And one day, while he was on his way to murder more Christians, because he was a terrorist to the Christian church. He was killing people that believed in Jesus, and he enjoyed it because he really believed in his heart that he was right. He believed in his heart he was doing the right thing. And so after God knocked him off his horse one day, made him blind for a couple of days, and then gave him his sight back, filled him with the Holy Ghost, something happened in the life of Paul, and he can't help but share it wherever he goes. I wish more Christians were like that. They realized, like Paul did, that God brought him from disgrace to grace. And I'm telling you, look at me, please. I'm telling you, I want you to understand this. You may think I'm picking on you, but I'm not. I want you to understand this. You, before Christ, were in a place of disgrace. Okay. Can I look for some truthful people on this side? You, before Christ, were in a disgrace. You weren't living right. Every single one of us, the Bible says, have fallen short. We have fallen short. And had it been for Christ, that even while we were a mess, turn to your neighbors, I was a mess. Even while we were a mess, even at that point, Christ died for us. He believed in us. He saw that God, his Father, had a plan for our lives, and Jesus was sold out to that plan that his Father had for us, that he died on that cross, was buried, and was resurrected to make sure that that plan that God has for your life comes to pass. What love God has shown unto us. Do you realize that? The most powerful reason, I believe, for the resurrection of Christ was that Christ, the Son of God, wanted to make sure that the plan of God for your life would come to pass. But he knew that we were in such a mess that unless something happened that would totally change our lives, make us new creations, unless that happened, the plan of God for our lives would not come to pass. And so Jesus died, was buried, and was resurrected, and he rose again for our behalf, that whosoever believed on him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That if you became born again, you are now a new creation, no longer a slave to the disgrace that you were in, because now believing in Christ has caused you to come from disgrace to grace. From disgrace to grace, because you are now a new creation. The plan of God is being developed in your life, is effective in your life. And so that's why you needed to be born again. Because when the first Adam was born again, he messed it all up. And because he messed it all up, he didn't only mess it up for him, but he messed it up for us. But when the second Adam came, turn to someone and say, that was Jesus. When the second Adam came, amen, what the first Adam messed up, Jesus, the second Adam, had to redo all over again. That's why he had to die and all over again. So that when he redid it all over again, the way God had planned it in the first place, the one that the stuff that, that the plan that Adam messed up, but God said, no, I'm still going to have my way. And because of the sacrifice, follow me. I'm so excited because of the sacrifice of Christ. And when you received him, the second Adam, you got born again. That's why you had to get born again, because the first man, Adam, that was born again, that represented us, messed up. And in order for your lives to be changed, you had to be made into a new creation. But a new creation doesn't live like the old creation. A new creation doesn't think like the old creation. A new creation doesn't talk like the old creation. New creation does not live like the old creation. It can't. The new creation does not know what the old was like. They're brand new. They're not redone. They're not refurbished. We're not refurbished. And we still have used parts in us. We don't have any used parts in us. We are brand spanking new spiritually, brand spanking new in the eyes of God. We have no business referring to any refurbished parts. There are none in us. Well, you don't know my history. You should have no history. How can a new creation have history? Why do we contradict the simplicity of the Word of God? Turn to somebody and say, he's still talking about the basics. This is very basic to believe that Jesus resurrected to make you a brand new creation. How many of you believe you're a brand new creation? Shout if you believe that. And I'm with you, and I'm in full agreement. But you have to be new in your way of thinking. You can't be new and think the old way. Listen, if I'm going to buy a new house, I'm not going to bring in old furniture. If I'm going to buy a new house, I'm not going to bring in some old. Why would I do that? If I buy a new house, I'm going to make sure I bring in brand new furniture to keep everything new. Can you say amen? Now, it may take me time, whatever, but my aim is to bring in new furniture. If all I have is an old bed, I'm not going to bring it into, I'll sleep on the carpet. I'm not bringing anything old into something new. And that's what happens to us when spiritually, when we're born again. We're new creation, but we bring old stuff in. Old hurts. Old pains. Old memories. And what happens is that old stuff begins to fester and mold, and we're no longer, before we knew it, hey man, what happened? I haven't seen your church. Oh man, I don't know, you know? I do. You brought in old stuff. Somebody's got to love me right about now. I'm really a nice guy. I really am. But all I'm sharing with you is the basics, and this is what the Apostle Paul was sharing in Romans chapter 5. He was just trying to tell the church in Rome how much God loves them. And if they understand how much God loves them, listen, have you ever loved somebody that even when they did wrong, you did wrong with them because you loved them, although you knew it was wrong? Don't raise that. Look at me. I can tell you I have. I have family members. I've loved them so much that when they did wrong, I did wrong. Why? Somos familia, homes. Cubo. Alivianate. Why? Because we're family, man. I love them, dude. And I told them I'd be by their side, dude. I ain't going to abandon. Shut up. Why don't we say that to God? I'm going to be by your side, and I'm not going to abandon you. No matter what you do, God, I'm right there with you. Why don't we use the same way of thinking towards the things of God? Oh, because it's silly. No, it's not. It's more silly the way you were serving the devil. That was plain out stupid the way we all serve the devil. And we abandoned ourselves to the devil. I abandoned myself to alcohol. I abandoned myself to a gang lifestyle. I abandoned myself to drugs. I abandoned myself. And when they said, well, wait, this is who I am, eh? It wasn't who I was. It's who the enemy wanted me to be. Down deep in my heart, I would cry because I'd say, there's got to be a better way of living. And I didn't know what it was then. But when I met Jesus Christ and he came into my life and I accepted, I just want to thank God for my salvation. Hey. And just as excited as I get about God, I used to get just as excited for alcohol. And I used to get just as excited for drugs. And just as I used money and I'd scheme and think where to get my money for my next hit or for my bottle of booze or for whatever I needed, I wanted to make sure I had that money. I'm the same way about the things of God. I want to make sure I have something to give to him. I threatened people's lives, took their money so I could make sure I had money for the devil. And now it comes to God and I can't give to God. Look at me, I'm talking to you. Really? Really? You'd stay up all night planning on where to get your next wham wham zuzu and all that stuff. You would know what I'm talking about, right? Huh? You wanted to make sure you had money. You had enough money on your books, even out in the world, so that when the stuff came, you had enough money to pay. Oh, am I talking? Am I the only one that did that? Am I the only one that did that? Are you all guys from Beverly Hills? You never did anything like that? You remind me of people in jail. Everybody's innocent. Nobody ever did nothing. No. Huh? And now we become born. I'm talking about the basics. I'll get to my sermon maybe. We're talking about being born. Born. That means you are brand spanking new. And to God be the glory. I said, to God be the glory. And so now that you're born again, you've got to learn how to enjoy your born again life. I don't know about you, but people used to say, you know, you get born again, everything's going to be all right. That was a lie, man. When I got born again, all hell broke loose. When you get born again, you know, you're going to tiptoe through the tulips. Seven. Tiptoeing through thorn bushes. But God's always been there to rub my feet, heal the wound, because I'm born again. And so there's a lot of people that are struggling in their born again life because now that they're saved, they don't know how to enjoy their born again life. And it's hard to get people to do new things after they've been doing what they've been doing for so long. Now, when I was raised up, and I'm not making fun of anybody, I'm just sharing my story so nobody get offended, okay? If I share my story, then I'll get offended at me. But you don't get offended at me, okay? When I was raised up, I'll go to church. And if I didn't have a dollar for the basket, my mom or my grandmother who raised me would always make sure I had something to give. And I don't know if there was too many people here who were as poor as we were. I don't know. But my grandmother always made sure I had something to give. Now, I would take what my grandmother gave and go buy me beer. So I gave it to the guy at the store. But I gave. I was just giving to the wrong person. Who are you giving to? Man, I'm surprising myself tonight. Why are you yawning? Am I boring? I'm kidding. It's long. I understand. I do that because I love her, and she can handle it, because I know if I did it to some of you, you'd never come back. Because she stopped coming back a long time ago. I had to get. No, she didn't. I love her, and I just do that to her out of nowhere. Who are you giving to? Now, if you're a new creation, you should not be given to the old stuff. If you're a new creation, you shouldn't be giving to the old stuff. It's a brand new start. You need to start giving to the right stuff. There are more people afraid of the IRS than they are of God. Because they fall behind on their taxes. And you know how happy they get, Sister Desi, when the IRS forgives that debt and gives them an opportunity to start all over again. Oh, yes. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Huh? Now we thank Jesus. And we're excited because the IRS forgave us our debt, and Jesus died on the cross to forgive you your debts. So that, oh God, but we fear the IRS more than we do God. And we figure, well, I'll give to the IRS. I'm sure God won't mind if I don't give to him. You think so? Now, I'm talking to new creation people who are still dealing with old stuff. We're going to get rid of the old stuff today. Amen? Husbands, I'm not talking about your wives. Wives, I'm not talking about your husbands. Some of you smile and said, oh, God, I'm going to get a new one. No. Let's not go down that road. I didn't take you there. You went there on your own. So who are you giving to? And let's get away from money. Who are you giving more time to? Who are you giving more attention to? Well, let's toss that money stuff out. Let's off the table. Who are you giving more dedication to? Now, you're a new creation now. You used to give more money at the drug house. You used to give more money at the girly bar. Oh, no. Yes, you did. If you keep lying to me, I'm going to ask God to put a television right there, and I'm going to look and see everything that you did. And I'm not. There's nothing wrong with that. Giving money at the girly bar. Wait, let me finish. The Bible tells you so, that sin was good. Oh, you don't know how good it was, do you? Come on, you remember. Remember. The Bible says sin was good for a season, but it was not good when it caught up to you. But before it caught up to you, turn to your neighbor and say, it was good. It was so good that now that you're a new creation, it's hard to break off of. I set you up and you fell for it. Your new creation still stuck to that old good thing. That old good thing catches up to you. It's on. It ain't good. There's a price and there's a consequence. And you know what Jesus said? He looked at you and he looked at me first, because I'm probably older than you. So I was probably there first, except, well, no, some of us. And he said, you can't handle the consequences of your sin. It'll kill you. You cannot handle it. all that stuff you did, all when that thing comes to knock to collect, you will not be able to pay. And he was right. And he said, but don't worry. My son will pay a price that nobody else will ever have to pay. So when that thing comes knocking and it says, I came to collect, and you say, no, that was the old me. I'm a new creation. I didn't do that. I didn't do that. That was the old. I'm the new. Hey, remember when you did? No, I didn't do that. Yes, you did. I was there. I didn't do it. No, yes, you did. No. That was the old. I'm the new. I haven't done that. I will not do that. I don't want to do that. Oh, you're talking silly and you're talking stupid. I'm about to slap you. Keep trying to tell me I'm the old one. Hey, remember when we, nope, we didn't. But we did. No, we didn't. But how can you forget? Forget, I don't even remember. But you were there. No, I wasn't there. Yes, you were. No, I wasn't. That was the old me. I'm the new me. I've never done it. I've never been there. Don't want to go there. Don't want to do it. I've never done it. I'm a new creation. Hallelujah. So who are you giving your time to as a new creation? Are you still giving more time to the old stuff than you are to the one who made you new and paid that price for you? Who are you talking to more? Who do you think about more? Or what do you think about more? And all this stuff, and I probably could go on and on and on along those lines, attempting to prove one simple point, that the new has nothing to do with the old. But sure, it's quiet in this awesome church. It's quiet tonight. And the reason I bring those things up is because I believe with all of my heart that you need to learn how to enjoy your new life. And you need to ask yourself, why am I not enjoying my born again life? Why am I not enjoying my new life? Did not Jesus say, I've come to give you and to give it to you more? In other words, I didn't just come to give you life. I came to give you this life you know nothing about, but I'll teach you. And so we get the teachings, and maybe we hear them once a week. Maybe once a month. And we feel that once a week, once a month equation. But when we were the old us, we were in the neighborhood every day. We were using every day, not once a month, not once a week like we attend church. We were using every day. We were gangbanging every day. Not you, Mario, but Serena was. I saw her. That's how rumors get started. Too late. It's on YouTube. Just for YouTube, I made it up. Huh? We were out there every day. Not you, Anthony, but your wife was. Hallelujah. I remember seeing her too. We used to party, but not really. Huh? You were there every day. You were partaking every day. What are you doing? We are fellowshipping. And you couldn't wait to get there. Huh? You couldn't wait to get there. The party started 7, you were there at 5. Maybe not in the house, but at the door going, open, open, open. Huh? And then you were the first to get there, and you'd be the last to leave. You all right? Yeah, I'm all right. Why? Somebody's following me. See him? Give the Lord a praise, somebody. Hallelujah. Huh? Or do you finish this and then you ask for a Hershey bar before you fall asleep? chocolate. Dude, you just bought that shirt. Why are all the holes? I must have fallen asleep, Holmes. Huh? We did that. Listen to me. We did that every day. Every day as the old creation. And now we are a... Some of us are still doing the old. But God is saying, no. You won't enjoy your new life living the old life. And so I'm trying to teach you how to enjoy being a new creation. That's what the Apostle Paul was trying to do. And so some of us have been doing this so long that we need to get back to the basics. You don't know as much as you thought you knew. If you did, you wouldn't be doing the old stuff. Can I sidetrack here a little bit? Can I sidetrack? What time is it? Oh, shoot. I thought it was 10 already. Okay. Can I sidetrack? Let me sidetrack. What was I going to say? You know why it's so easy? Here's what I was going to say. Well, that's not, but I made it up, so it feels like this is what I was going to say. No, it is. It is. Listen to me. You know why it's so easy to get back to the old stuff? Because our flesh knows we can do that. Because we've done it before. We've been there before. It's easier to get back to the old stuff than to stay in the new you. Now, Christ has made it easy for us to stay in the new us through his word. But we're not always in the word. We're still in the old. You see, Christ has made it easy for us. But we struggle because the flesh makes it hard for us. Our emotions make it hard for us. Our feelings make it hard for us. And so when things get tough, oh man, what's the use? There we go. We go back to the old stuff. Why? Because we've been there before. We're comfortable there. We've done it before. The flesh wants to do it. We never gave it up when we became new. We held on to it. We're bringing old furniture into the new house. And it's only a matter of time. Have you ever seen, driven down the street, and then you see new houses go up, or new apartments, or new condominiums go up? Man, they look pretty. I mean, manicured lawns. I mean, the paint job is phenomenal. And then they have families, not like yours, but like you know who's. They're not here tonight. They have family move in, and it's a matter of time that you drive by there again, and the grass is about this high. Huh? The doors are off the hinges. Come on, they got tires on the roof. They got broken down cars parked in that manicured lawn. Huh? And what happened? They moved into a new house, but they brought in all of that old stuff. And that's the way it is in the spirit for you and I. We become a new creation, but after a while, the spiritual door in the house is on its hinges. Amen. You walk in and those demons, they used to be your friends, now they're demons all kicking back. Oh, yeah. In the new house. The lawn in the new house all messed up. And then we want God to bless us more. Really? And Jesus is saying, I want to show you. I'm going to send Paul. And I want to show you how to live a more abundant life. Ms. Gallegos, would you? Hallelujah. So Romans 5, we're talking about the first thing that Paul was teaching is he was teaching them about God. And oftentimes, our understanding of God is not where it needs or what it needs to be. We're very limited. And I wouldn't want to do this. I don't want to do this. But I remember one day, oh, check this out. You're going to laugh. Maybe you were here. One day, I came out here. The place was packed. And I said, all right, everybody stand up. Everybody stood up. I said, I'm gonna give you 5 seconds to name me 10 popular beers. I said, I want you to shout them out, and say, ready? He said, yeah. Okay, ready? Begin. Coors. Everybody, oh, shouting them all out. And those that weren't shouting were actually shouting louder by not shouting because they were a bust every time I lose. They'd be, everybody shouting about the beer, and they'd be like this. I didn't even give a scripture. And they were shouting all these beers. And I said, okay, time's up. Now give me the 10 commandments. New creations. Born again. You become a new creature in Christ. No problem naming me the 10 top beers, but couldn't give me all the 10 commandments. Give me the 10 commandments. Yes. Cleanliness is next to godliness. Stupid, that's not a commandment. It's a good principle, but it's not in the Bible. How many of you know it's not in the Bible? See, some of you thought it was in the Bible. It's not even in the Bible. How about, give me another commandment. Yes. What is it? Don't worry, be happy. That's a dumb reggae song, dude. Oh, it is? Yeah, well, they told me. And the Apostle Paul's trying to say, no. When you get into this word, God begins to teach you. And the first thing that God begins to teach you is that God is so much more than people think he is. You can give the Lord a praise there. See, what happens is okay, see the cross? What happens is I get saved, I get born again. And so God, through that, draws me to the cross where Jesus was crucified, died, was buried, and resurrected. But then I never move beyond that. I stay at the cross. And you've got to understand the cross and what happened at the cross before you go anywhere else. But you can't stay here. God wants you to understand what happened at the cross, that when you enter your new creation, because of what happened at the cross, you begin to enjoy your new life because of the blood that his son shed on that cross. But most people are stuck at the cross. Most people here, some people here tonight, are stuck at the cross. And thank God for the cross. But I'm here to tell you what Paul was trying to say. God, now that you understand what happened at the cross, God now becomes much more than just what happened at the cross. Now you live and you become a witness and you give testimony because you believe with all your heart that because of what happened at the cross, you can now become that new creation and enjoy your new life. So, through the Old Testament said in Isaiah, by his stripes you, so it points, that scripture points to the cross. By his stripes, man, you are healed. You get here, and you go beyond the cross, and 1 Peter says what? By his stripes you were healed. You're on your way to your new life. Isaiah says you are healed. Say thank you. You come over here and you look back and say you were. When? When were you? When Isaiah said I was. You are. Because Isaiah said you are. I come over here, and so now I am. By his stripes, you were healed. By his stripes, I am healed. Now I'm enjoying my new life. Over here, I was an old sinner. I come here, thank you, hallelujah. And here, I am the righteousness of Christ in Christ Jesus. Over here, I was always getting my booty kicked by everything and everybody, everything that I did. But I come here, God saves me and brings me from disgrace Thank you. To grace. Huh? And so here, I'm getting my booty kicked. Hallelujah. And now, I am more than a conqueror through Christ. Ha! Who loves me? Now, I'm beginning to understand what Paul is talking about. God is much more than I thought he was over here. But now that I understand and I'm grateful, now I know and I'm learning that God is much more than he was over there. I didn't know God over there. Not like I should have. But I know God here because I understood what his son did here. But I don't stay here. Because of what his son did here, I come over here and I enjoy. I went from disgrace because of the blood to grace. And through grace, to me, God is much more than he was for me over there. Over here, I was just Cisco. Why are you laughing? That was my street name. I don't laugh at you because they called you payaso. Or sad girl. Or payasa. I don't laugh at you. That's all I was over here. Lost. Good for nothing. Attempted suicide 2 times. That's where I was over here. Exactly. A lot of you didn't know that. Then somebody led me here. And they led me to the cross. And I received Christ as my Lord and Savior. Here, I am no longer dead to Christ. I am alive to Christ, but I'm dead. Whoa. I'm alive to Christ, but I'm dead to that sin. I'm dead to that sin. And here, I'm alive to Christ. Oh, come on. So now I'm the head. Over there was the tail. Now I'm the head. Over here, I'm above. Over here, I was underneath. But over here, I'm above. There was these 2 guys walking to the market, hadn't seen each other for years, bumped into one another. One says to the other, hey, Frank, or whatever. I haven't seen you in years. How you doing? He says, oh, I'm doing all right under the circumstances. And the other guy says, what are you doing under the circumstances? What are you doing under the circumstances? Christ died to bring you above and conquer the circumstances and conquer those situations. What are you doing under there? That's not your position. That was your position here, but you got saved. Grace and mercy and favor. Now you were under, but because of Christ, you're above. I'm blessed coming in and going out. Hey! Hey, my time's up. Give the Lord a praise. Come on, give the Lord a praise. Hallelujah. I'm going to have to go to part 3. I never got into part 2, so I'll go to part 3. But I believe that God is saying it's so important for him and for you to learn how to enjoy your new life in Christ. Hey, how you doing? Oh, I'm all right. That's the old you. You're a new creation. You're better than all right. You're blessed. You're blessed. I'm not all right. When I was the old creation, yeah, I'm okay. How you doing? Oh, I'm standing in there. Judas stood in there and I'm hanging in there. How you doing? I'm hanging in there. Judas hung in there and he died. Hola, Paco, ¿cómo estás? Huh? And I pray I've shaken some of your situations tonight. I pray I've invaded somehow your old way of thinking. I pray I interrupted that. I pray I intruded tonight. And I pray I stirred you up. I pray I got some of you a little aggravated at me. But you should be so aggravated that you should go home and then go like this to your Bible. Open it up and see if I was wrong. You know, I just got my new iPhone, iPhone 7 Plus. Yeah, iPhone 7 Plus right here. I've had it for a week. No? Yeah, 4 or 5 days, you're right. And you know what the first thing I did? I got on my iPad and on my new iPhone. Yeah, the first thing I did was drop it. Let's not go there. That was old, okay? I did. I went to get it, you know, protected and stuff, and I opened it up. Can you protect my... And my daughter goes, "Hi, Dad." And I go, "See, I me. You know what the first thing I did? I went on my iPad and I went on my new iPhone and I downloaded, number one, because it was new, I downloaded the manual. No, I downloaded the manual for the phone. Don't get super religious on me right now. I wish I was, okay, so I should have downloaded the Bible first. All right. I didn't. Crucify me. Okay. Game face. I downloaded first the manual for the iPhone so I could learn more about it. And then I downloaded tips and tricks so I could learn how to better enjoy it. You don't have to download anything if you don't want. But in order to learn how to live your new life, you have to get the manual. And not only get it, you know what some of you done? You went and bought the Bible. When you got saved, you went and bought the Bible. But you went to the Christian store and you picked the biggest one, the heaviest. Then you go home. Amen? Because you've already polished the table in the living room, right? Because you don't want any germs on the Bible, right? And you go home and you go, you never see it, you never read it again. It's right there. Because you want everybody to know when they walk in your house that you have the 45-pound Bible. Remember you put little fringes around their Bible covers? You're not that old, okay? And you never read it again. And it doesn't make any sense. Here's where you learn to live your new life and to keep the old life conquered. That you do not bring old furniture into the new house. Has the Holy Spirit helped anybody here tonight? The decision, my friend, is yours. Choose you this day whom you will serve. God can't force you to serve him. But whoever you're going to serve, don't be a hypocrite. If you're going to serve the devil, then serve him. But if you're going to serve God, then serve God. Look at me. I'm talking to you. Cut out the old stuff. Get the manual. Read it every day. I've learned so much about my new iPhone in 4 days because I keep reading. And I'll read till the new one comes out, and then I'll get the manual for that one. He who has an ear and a love for God, hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to you. We've laughed. And I think God kind of rebuked us tonight, but we laughed right through it. It's grace and mercy and love. No more games. No more, I'll try this, I'll try that. No more. That was on this side of the cross. And then you come here, thank you. Now you're on this side of the cross. Every head bowed and eye closed in reverence to the Lord. Nobody looking around, please, please. Now, if you're here tonight and you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you've never asked Him to forgive you your sins, you've never repented of your sins, and what I've said today or what the Spirit of God has said today has really shaken you and challenged you. Now, you've had opportunities, but you never responded. But the Spirit of God is pulling on you now. And if you're here tonight and you're ready to receive Jesus Christ, come from disgrace to grace, from old to brand new. Would you raise your hand and say, "Preacher, I'm ready. I need Jesus." God bless you. Anybody else? Nobody looking around, nobody talking, nobody nothing. Eye closed, head bowed. I'm not going to embarrass you in any way, shape, or form, but we do have a big spotlight to put on you here. Okay. How about you that do know Christ and you do have a new life and you have come from here to here, but you brought some of the old stuff with you? If you're here, raise your hand. Thank you. Thank you. I got mine raised too. Thank you. 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 Then I guess tonight's word was from all of us, right? All you that raised your hand and you that didn't, but know you should have, stand with me, please. God has given us divine instruction tonight. I'm so grateful for that. I'm so grateful. You have no idea how grateful. I've never shared any of this with anybody. I mean, it was birthed in me tonight by the Holy Ghost. And it's easy because this is how my wife and I were raised. We were taught this over and over and over again till it was no longer an issue in our spirit. And that's where you have to get to. Hear it over and over and over again. Read it over and over and over again. Read Romans, all of it. Then go to Big John in the front of your Bible. And it'll talk to you about God's love for you. And then you go to Little John in back of the Bible. And it reinforces what you read in Big John about how much God loves you. And you have to be settled in that. You have to be settled in the great love that God has for you before you start enjoying your new life. I married my wife. Once I did, I married her because it was settled in my heart how much she loved me. There was about five other girls I was going to marry, but they didn't. Then this little girl came by in hot pants. Anthony, you should have been there, homie. No sabes, hermano, no sabes. And I've enjoyed her ever since because I know she loves me. And that's how I enjoy God. I enjoy God because I know He loves me. And there's nothing that I will intentionally do to hurt Him. Intentionally. How about you? Get back to that place, friend. The basics of living for God. The basics of living for God. A lot deeper than we thought they were, but they're still very basic. What I shared with you today, without insulting you in any way, shape, or form, or desiring to, because that's not my intention, but I must remind you that what I've shared with you today is what our children are learning in Sunday school. It's just that we've forgotten. We've gone through so much mess, haven't we? Have you? I know I have. Have you? But we should have never abandoned it. I should have never abandoned it. Should have never backslid for 7 years like I did. Should have never done that. Should have never. No excuse. No excuse. But it was easy for me to backslide because I've been there before. And that's where my flesh took me. My spirit was saying, but my flesh said, I didn't obey my spirit because I'd never been over there where the Spirit of God was taking me. I had never been over there. And it was going to take faith for me to get there. My flesh said, no, come on, you know what it's like over here. You've been here, let's go. Yeah. I didn't need faith to get over here. No faith at all. But I need a lot of faith to get to where God wanted to take me. So Paul said this, remember, Romans 5. He said this, the just, those that have come from disgrace to getting saved, thank you, and become the new creation, to grace those, the just, those that are on this side, shall live by faith. Because without faith, Hebrews 11:6, it is impossible to please God. Once you make that transition from there to here, now it's a life of faith. But it's not blind faith. It's faith in the God that got you from over there to over here. And when you know that it took his son to shed blood to get you from over there to over here, it's easy to have faith in a God like that once you make up your mind. It's easy to have a faith in a God who gave his only begotten son for you and for me. When nobody else would give us a time of day, God gave his son. What do you say, folks? We clear out the old today? Start today. Start today. When you get home, ladies, some of you ladies, tear up those old pictures. Orale. Huh? Tear up those old pictures. Don't be like my wife was years ago. I'm trying to make a point, homie. She asked me to go get some out of her drawer. So I went, you know. I was looking for that stuff and I find a picture. Orale. Her and her ex. Oh yeah, 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 yeah. So I walk up to her, I go, hey, hey, hey. I go, hey, little redhead. No, she wasn't redhead then. She wasn't Destiny Red then. I go, Linda. She goes, yeah, babe. I said, don't babe me. In my heart, I didn't say it out loud. I was too close. And Linda, she goes, yeah? What's this? What? She does that. Linda, what's this? What? Well, this. What? Well, turn around and look! So you go, oh, where'd you get that? In the drawer where you had it. Oh, that's nothing. I've always meant to, you know, tear his part out. Sure you did. Yeah, and I'm King Kong. Don't do that. I busted her, Bo. I busted her. Busted her. But I was a Christian, so I forgave her. Tear up old memories. Tear up and get rid. Uproot. 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 Get rid of old feelings. Old ways of thinking. Now, some stuff's going to hurt. But I'll tell you what. It'll never hurt you more than it did Jesus Christ. Never. And once you get over your pain, and you got to get over it quick because it'll take you down. Well, how do I get over my pain? Turn to your neighbor and tell him, just get over it. Come on, you know how to do that. Don't act like you need a psychologist up here to explain you how to get over it. Just get over it. Well, how do I stop? I'm going to finish right now. How do I stop the devil from pushing my buttons? The devil knows how to push my buttons. And you know what? The devil always comes and pushes this button because he knows what button to push. How many of you have heard that? Only three of us. Okay, some of you, there's no hope. You know how? You know how you stop the devil from pushing that button? You get rid of the button. Hello. He can't push what is not there anymore. Cubo. Cara de tubo. Huh? You get rid of the button. You get rid of the unforgiveness. You get rid of the bitterness. You get rid of pride. You get rid of that stuff that makes you hate yourself because you made that mistake. You get rid of it. And when he comes to push it, it's not going to be there to push. But guess what? He'll find another button to push. It's called the process. And once he pushes that button, then you say, ah, there's another one I got to get rid of. And that's the way it is when you're serving God. Another button. Ah, phew, another button. It's dumb to let the devil come and keep pushing the same button all the time. And you're falling for the same thing over and over again. Turn to someone and say, just get rid of the button. Turn to somebody else and say, just like you got rid of old, no, don't say the name. God loves you. God loves you. I want to thank everybody. I want to thank Mario, Serena. I mean, except for what? I want to thank Mario and Serena for robbing the bank next door. Oh, you guys are bad. You're not supposed to do it. For stepping up one more time and heading the harvest. I want to thank the Harvest Planning Committee. I want to thank our pastors and our ministry leaders that stepped up. That stepped up. We gave away about 20 bikes. We saved some for next year. That's how many we had. We didn't have time to give away all the bikes. So we just gave, I don't know how many at once at the end. It was phenomenal. It's great to have more than enough. It's an abundance. I want to thank all of them. I want to thank all the volunteers. It was a lot of work. It was a lot of work. I was brokenhearted because when we made the altar call, I didn't count. But two people that counted, one said we had 13, the other one said we had 11 or 12 salvations for the glory of God. So we grew the kingdom one more time. Not the church. God will grow the church. We grow the kingdom. And that's what we did. Thank you all so very, very much for that. Do we have any new announcements? Anything new? Two? Come on up and then you may sit down and then we'll be quickly dismissed, I promise you.